Well, welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us for this webinar. My name is Juliette, and I'm excited to be your host, especially today as we see a record participation with almost 600 people registered for this session. So beyond the figure itself, there is no secret, user experience and performance monitoring, it is a major concern when transitioning to the cloud. So before we get started, if you have any questions during the presentation, please type them in the chat window and we'll have an open Q&A session at the end. Okay, let's begin with an introduction of today's speakers. Jeff, would you like to start?
Yes, of course. Hello, everybody. So my name is Jeff. You can call me as well Jean-François Piot. That's my real name. I am at GSX for now 10 years, and I'm in charge for the product marketing. Also, I oversee most of the content we publish on the internet, and I'm always looking for new ideas of topics that will be interesting for the community. So let us know in the chat if you have any ideas about topics that you would like us to explore, either on the webinar or in our Robotech section that we have on our website. Garth?
Hello, everybody. My name is Garth Fisher. I am a customer success engineer here at GSX, as well as a member of the client satisfaction team, and I'm also a Microsoft certified solutions expert.
Okay. Very good. So, well, let's go to the agenda. So the purpose of this webinar today is to focus on Office 365 performance issue and, of course, how to troubleshoot them. All the situations we will see in this webinar already happened at our customers. We have reproduced them in order to show you how network configuration or equipment can have a real impact on the end user experience. So let's start by clearly defining responsibilities between you and Microsoft. So, Garth, if we can go on the next slide. The first important point in the Microsoft SLA is the information you need to provide when you submit a claim to their customer support. So to validate a claim, Microsoft is asking for a detailed description of the incident, that's pretty normal, information regarding the time and the duration of the incident, so you need to provide data for that, the number of locations that were affected by the incident, and the description of your attempt to resolve the incident. So a first question that naturally comes to mind is, how do you get all this data? How do you collect the data at the moment of the incident? And how do you prove that some locations were affected? Secondly, you need to be aware of SLA limitations that are, for example, anything happening outside of reasonable control, anything happening outside of their data center, and anything happening due to a non-visible use of their service. So basically, the SLA is delivered at the edge of the data center when it is used in a normal way. These conditions are pretty normal, but we also understand that they won't cover 90% of the performance issues you might face. So, quick question on how is calculated their SLA? What is the SLA for Exchange, Skype, or Teams, for example? For Exchange Online, so downtime is defined by any period where end users are unable to send or receive the email with Outlook Web Access. So again, a good question you might have is, how do I detect any issue besides end user complaint? How do I prove that there were an issue with mail routing if I don't test it every minute and if I don't collect and store the statistics? Another question is, what happened when FreeBSD is slow, for example? What happened when I have an issue with any other feature of Exchange Online, like meeting creation, search, etc.? The answer is, basically, you are on your own. Microsoft can help you, but will make you pay for it, and you won't be able to file a claim because it's outside of their SLA. So, you would better have all the information you need to fix the issue yourself. Let's check, for example, the Teams SLA. And Teams is pretty new, so there's only one SLA, and it is based on chat feature. Any issue with call or any other feature are outside of their SLA. For Skype, there are three SLAs, one on the instant messaging, one on the PSTN call and conference, and a last one on voice quality. The two first ones are pretty obvious because they are directly related to the availability of the service. But like for Exchange Online, how do you prove that the service was unavailable yesterday between 8 and 8:30 a.m. in Singapore if you don't test it continuously? The last SLA on Skype is about voice quality. For that, Microsoft basically calculates a network MOS that predicts what would be the end user quality call ranking. Then they check how long this poor quality call lasts and calculate a ratio between poor and good quality calls. The network MOS is based on a constant measurement of the round-trip time, packet loss, jitter, and concealment factors. But again, how can you back your claim if you're not collecting these statistics and calculating constantly the same network MOS from all your locations? And when you detect an issue, how do you troubleshoot it? So that's basically what we will try to answer today. So Garth, you can go on the next slide. So the first topic we will try to define, to check, is how do you detect a local or a tenant issue? So most of you have already experienced some end-user complaints about performance of one or multiple Office 365 services in one or multiple locations. The first question you have to answer after a complaint is it really an issue? I mean, people complain all the time, and not necessarily for a real reason. Maybe the coffee this morning was not strong enough, maybe the night was shorter than usual. What does it mean when someone says that something is slow? First, you need to acknowledge the reality of the incident. Then you need to understand its impact. Is it just one location, or is the problem starting to happen in every other location? And then you have to analyze the issue. Is it your responsibility or not? Can you do something about it, or is it Microsoft's service issue? So let's see how you can easily face all these challenges with our JSX robot user. Garth, can you show us what to do?
Absolutely, Jeff, and thank you. So as Jeff was saying, being able to differentiate between a local IT or a tenant-wide issue can be very challenging. It is an issue that faces a lot of organizations on a daily basis. So for this particular task, we have three robot users set up at three different locations. We have them all performing the same Office 365 monitoring and all under the same load. We have one at our office in Pennsylvania, another robot user in our New York office, and another robot user in Azure. Let's take a look at this here. So here you can see, I mean, if you're not familiar with our tool, I mean, clearly, you know, green means everything is good. Any other color than that, you know, you're having some type of an issue. So here we can see that we're clearly having an issue in our office in Pennsylvania, but again, that's still not good enough to go ahead and say you're having a tenant-wide issue, it's just one office. So then when we factor in our New York office, we can see, hey, we're also having an issue out of the New York office. Again, two different locations having issues, again, it's still not enough to really say there's a tenant-wide issue going on here. But then when we take a look at all of our locations, including the robot user we have running out of Azure, you can see that all locations are having a similar performance issue. So at a quick glance, you can see again that we are having some type of subpar Office 365 performance resulting in poor end user experiences. Let's take a quick look at some of this data as it's aggregated together for all three different locations. So again, here's all the different robot users and their locations, and yes, this one really is running out of Azure. But anyway, so as you can see here, these are some of the actions that are being performed across all our various different robot users. For now, we're just gonna take a quick look at FreeBusy, for example. Here you can see it's bad everywhere. It's really bad out of, it looks like Pennsylvania, but either way, it's still bad across the board, including in Azure. Now, even at this point, it's still not, you know, good enough amount of data to really go to Microsoft and say, hey, we're having an issue across the tenant, because again, we're only looking at one particular action. And as far as our checks are concerned, it's very important to take a look at all the different actions you can perform against the services out of Office 365. So to take a look at that, we're gonna basically look at the data across a greater range of time to see what we're going to be looking at here. So let's take a look at that. So here we're showing some of one of our Power BI dashboards that basically, you know, aggregates all the data from all our different locations that we're doing these performance checks against Office 365. And this will, you know, paint the picture here that you can see that, you know, not only one action was bad, but all actions were bad across all the different sites. So here, if you take a look at Open Mailbox, for example, out of New York, you can see that's high all the time. We have the same thing going on out of Pennsylvania. The same thing happening in Azure all at the same time. Take a look at Create Meeting, for example, same thing here. And keep in mind that, by the way, like Create Meeting typically is about a 2-second action. So it, you know, here it's taking about 3 times that amount of time coming out of all the different locations, including Microsoft Azure. Download attachment is also, it's also pretty high. It's higher out of Pennsylvania, but, you know, it's still high across the board, across all the different locations. So based on this data that we've gathered over, you know, a certain amount of time, you can see that the performance was subpar across all the different locations, including Azure. This makes a strong case that it's not a local IT issue at the office locations. When you can correlate performance data from multiple office locations as well as Microsoft Azure, all showing the same poor performance on the same end user actions, then you have enough data to say, hey, maybe it's time to open, contact Microsoft and open a ticket. So here at GSX Monitoring Solutions, we'll provide solid performance metrics as they pertain to Office 365 that can help you provide evidence for when end users are experiencing subpar or poor performance as it pertains to Office 365. Jeff?
Okay, yeah, thank you. Thank you for your demonstration. Let's go now on our second topic, that is preventing Skype for Business Online voice quality complaints. So we've seen that Microsoft provides SLAs on voice availability and voice quality, but we've also seen that they rely on a constant measure of several metrics. And if you have issue with voice quality, you need to back your claim with all these statistics. So Garth will show you in a minute how you can easily do that with the GSX Robot user. Microsoft clearly explains that you should constantly measure these network metric and Skype voice quality statistics from your client side and from your data center edge. The purpose is to understand the impact of your own network on the Skype voice quality. So Garth, can you show us again how you can easily measure, collect these statistics and speak with Microsoft?
Absolutely, Jeff, thank you. So here we're going to take a look at our Gizmo dashboard, and we're going to go to the Skype voice section. Again, as I said before, you know, we use the color-coded LED so you can clearly and easily see when, you know, a particular Office 365 service or office location is experiencing an issue. So being able to actively and consistently monitor Skype for Business Online voice performance and alert when important metrics fall below acceptable thresholds is another challenge that's facing a lot of businesses today. Here at GSX, we provide this functionality in an easy to configure and easy to use monitoring solution. Before we go any further, let's just click in here on New York and just try to see some of the statistics that are going on as far as the Skype for Business voice testing is concerned. I know Jeff had touched on some of these points before and some of these different metrics that can have a negative impact on the Skype call, but I'm going to dive into some of these a little bit more for, you know, people who may not understand all of these different things that we're collecting. So as I said before, Jeff talked about the MOS or the mean opinion score. And, you know, everyone's seen this in some form or another. It's like when you get off of a Skype call and immediately after you get that little survey that pops up saying, hey, rate the call. How many stars would you give it? Did you experience this or that during the call? That's basically Microsoft's, you know, manual attempt to grab your experience and then, you know, calculate the various different metrics based on what the rating that you gave the call. Now, let's talk a little bit more about MOS as well and the factors that can affect it. Latency, of course, can have a negative impact on your MOS score, as well as packet loss, jitter, and the audio codec that is in use. Your MOS score can range from anywhere from 1 to 5, but when you factor in the impact of the audio codec, your highest score is usually around a 4.4. And here you can see out of New York, they're clearly having a lot of various different issues. The round trip latency is way above the threshold of 100 is over 5 times higher than that threshold. So let's talk a little bit more about some of these other factors, specifically the network MOS degradation average. Now, the network MOS degradation average, that shows the impact of jitter and packet loss on your call quality. Now, if this value is under 1, you're going to have a better call, the better the call quality will be. As this value increases, the quality of your call decreases. So basically, a high network MOS degradation value can cause blanks during the conversations as well as distortions, et cetera. And as you can see here, out of New York, they're almost double the threshold of 1. So let's also take a deeper dive in some of the other statistics here that can also affect Skype for Business voice calls. Let's talk about, again, the latency or round-trip latency. And again, that's pretty easy to understand. I mean, it's basically the round-trip time it takes for you to send the packet from point A to point B. When you have excessively high round-trip latency, this can have impacts on the call as far as the smoothness of the call is concerned. And when this value is too high, you'll have pauses during the conversation, or people sound like they're using a satellite phone or something like that. When you see jitter or excessively high jitter, jitter is basically like a buffer or a waiting room for your packets, right? So, you know, they all wait till they've all been received before it's transmitted to the other end. So a low jitter value, of course, is very good. And the high jitter value is going to be very bad for your calls. This is where you can see, you know, speeding up or slowing down of speech during calls. And I'm sure we've all been there at some point in time. Another important factor to talk about is the ratio concealed sample average, or just the healed ratio, as you can see here. And this is where Microsoft, you know, makes an attempt to basically hide or conceal any lost network packets during a call to make the call sound a lot smoother. So, of course, a high value of the healed ratio points to a potential poor call quality. A lower value of this healed ratio shows that you have a better network performance, and Microsoft didn't really have to do a whole lot to conceal, you know, any bad performance on the call or to basically help the quality of the call. We recommend basically a 2% or below on this here, and our threshold is at 7. And of course, you can see here out of New York, they're, you know, going a lot higher than that threshold. And of course, our MOS 3, you know, anything under 3, people are going to be hanging up and not really be happy with the call. And out of New York, you can see they're having a 2.45 MOS score. So, you know, everyone's not going to be happy, and no one's really going to be getting on those calls or want to continue those calls for much longer. So once again, we're going to reinforce this data by taking a look at these different performance metrics as they were gathered over time in one of our Power BI dashboards. So here you can see we're looking at the performance statistics out of New York and Pennsylvania. And as you can see, this is just reinforcing some of the data we're looking at in our Gizmo dashboard. Jitter is excessively high out of New York. You know, a lot higher than Pennsylvania. Again, there's our average MOS over time is 2.57. Again, lower than the score of 3. Whereas PA is having fantastic call quality, and everyone's happy there. Here again, you can see our average healed ratio is 15, more than double the threshold of about 7%. So, you know, even though there's a lot of different factors that can basically cause such a thing out of our New York office, but based on our, you know, over 20 years of experience of doing this type of monitoring, et cetera, and as well as the fact that, you know, when you see such high latency, you know, the first thing you should do is, of course, check the equipment you have control over, because once, you know, those packets leave your network, you know, it's up to your ISP, et cetera. But based on all these different factors, we were able to just say, hey, it looks like you're having a firewall issue. So we recommended that they check the firewall. And in a nutshell, it turned out that they had a bad router or a flapping router that was dropping packets as they were traversing the firewall, which resulted in the super high latency or round trip latency, which then had an adverse effect on all the different aspects, you know, that can affect the Skype voice call. That's it, Jeff.
Yep, thank you. So let's go now on our last topic of the day, that is to prevent Exchange Online end user issue. So, and before going specifically on Exchange Online, here are a few recommendations on network configuration for any Office 365 service. The figure here represents what we've seen at many customers and what is really not the best possible configuration. Every extra layer of network you add between the user and the Microsoft service slows down this service and is under your responsibility. For example, connection to Office 365 through a headquarter slows down any service by around 20%. That's what we have seen with our different robot user and different experience that we have seen at multiple customers. Another example, using authenticated proxy is really not recommended by Microsoft and affects the performance by another 20%. Bad DNS configuration can totally destroy the end user experience, so you should really check that point too. And we have numerous cases on that point, and that are described as well on our website. VPN usually creates as well performance issue and is clearly unnecessary and not recommended with Skype for Business Online, as for example, all the voice is already encrypted by Skype for Business. And finally, the closer the user are from an Office 365 tenant, the better the performance is. So Garth, can you show us a few examples on how to prevent or to detect this issue on Exchange Online?
Sure, Jeff, I would love to. So today we're going to take a look at an authenticating proxy and how it can impact the performance of Office 365 and the end user experience. We're going to go back to our Gizmo dashboard here and take a look at our Exchange Office 365 user experience. So for this scenario, I know it seems like we're picking on New York, right? But hey, that's how it is. But anyway, for this one here, we are doing a check out of our Boston office as well as out of the New York office. As you can clearly see based on our LED colors, Boston is just cruising along, everything is fine and dandy, but New York is not faring so well. So basically, an authenticating proxy can cause customers to have issues after installing it to connect to Office 365. And I'm sure, as a lot of you know, an authenticating proxy just requires users to authenticate before they can access the services being provided by Office 365. You know, this can lead to additional costs as well as you opening unnecessary tickets with Microsoft. So again, here we're looking at our two robot users in our Gizmo dashboard, one out of New York, one out of Boston. And of course, New York is the one using the authenticating proxy, and of course, Boston is not. And again, you know, these metrics are being gathered by our unbiased robot users that are free of emotions like a typical end user would be. You know, it's not something that's being reported by like Susan out of accounting who just had a terrible drive into the office this morning and is just not in a good mood overall. So we're going to take a deeper look at these statistics again in our Power BI dashboards. So let's get a look at that. So here you can see again the performance data that was gathered over a period of time for both the Boston and New York offices. And I know you see PA here, but that's not being included in the data that we're looking at. All right, so here you can see again that over this period of time, you know, we had 52 free busy lookups that were greater than the threshold of 4 seconds. Same thing, we had 18 resolve users that were also over the threshold of 4 seconds. So again, we're going to basically isolate this data and just take a look at New York again, only as it pertains to these various numbers that we were seeing here. So then if we just isolate this to just New York only, here you can see that out of the 52 free busy lookups that were greater than 4 seconds, 39 of them were out of New York only. So that was the bulk of it there. And then on this screen, which is both, you know, both offices aggregated together, you can see we had 18 resolve user that was greater than 4 seconds. And if we just isolate New York again only, which is the office using the authenticating proxy, you'll see that 17 out of those 18 resolve users that were gridded in the threshold were all coming out of the New York office. So basically, this scenario just shows, you know, just goes to show you how, you know, what someone may think is a great idea by setting up the authenticating proxy can increase the time for end users to access the Office 365 workloads, and you know, just leads to a poor user experience just based on the fact that it's going to take longer for them to access some of the workloads that they're trying to get to in Office 365. Jeff?
Yep. Well, thank you, Garth, again. So we've seen today that when you have to deal with Microsoft, I mean, you need data. And to have this data, you need to be able to collect them constantly and then to share them. And this is the purpose of our JSX robot user. But data are not only important to speak with Microsoft, you need also them to troubleshoot your own issues. You need them to understand what your users are telling you about performance. You need them to understand if there's a real issue or not, and you need them to understand how to improve the end user experience. At JSX, we developed solutions to really to build trust between end user, enterprise IT, and Microsoft. And we do that because we believe that with a common understanding about the end user experience, you and your company will be able to greatly increase the value you get from your cloud services. So I hope you like that webinar. And before we address the question, please keep in mind that our next webinar will be on May 17 and will be dedicated on the management of Office 65 SLA. So maybe now we can go through the question. Yeah.
Thank you, Jeff. Yeah, we'll go ahead and take some time for the questions now. Let's get started with the first one. Have you done some experiments with the VPN? And if so, how did they impact the service quality?
So the answer is yes. We have done experiments with the VPN, but mostly our customers have done experiments with the VPN. And so consistently, we've seen a degradation of end-user performance by between 10 and 20% using VPN. If it's for Exchange, it's maybe not that a concern because it's not like it's not. The email, sending email and receiving email at 10% difference, maybe not a big problem. As soon as you're on Skype for Business, it's dramatic because if you have a consistent loss of performance of 10% or even 15%, then as Garth showed, your MOS will be degraded, and then it's all your call that might be affected. So again, the VPN is really not recommended by Microsoft, especially on Skype for Business, and mostly because every communication on Skype for Business voice are already encrypted with TLS. So when you add a VPN, you add another encryption on an existing encryption, and of course, you really degrade the end user performance.
All right, thank you. Next one, how can I extract the data to present it to Microsoft supports?
Yeah, but maybe Garth, it's for you, that question, using Power BI to extract the data.
Yeah, sure. So you saw the Power BI dashboards I was displaying there, but one key thing to note is that while the monitoring solution and the Gizmo dashboard, you know, we're gathering the data, et cetera, and being able to render it in that Gizmo dashboard there, we're also, you know, collecting all this data in a SQL database on the back end. So that gives you a lot of flexibility there. You know, you have the ability to basically extract and, you know, do calculations on the data directly out of the SQL database if you're so inclined. But we also provide the same Power BI dashboard templates you were looking at earlier to you. So that'll, you know, help you out to extract the data. And those are also customizable. So you can move stuff around or just change the way it looks if you feel like it. And we're also working on some Sisense reporting as well that should be coming out very soon.
Thank you, Garth. Would you recommend implementing the quality of service in our network for Skype for Business?
So, of course, yes. the quality of service on in your network will allow you to save always a share of the bandwidth for your call. Also, if you have a problem with Skype for Business, especially for Skype for Business, we would recommend to take a look at Azure Express Route, because with Azure Express Route, you can have always a share of the bandwidth also that is dedicated to Skype for Business Voice. Meaning when you implement QoS in your network, it's good to do that, but you cannot force your ISP to do the same. When you take Azure Express Route, the QoS is already implemented in it. So it means that you would have end-to-end the QoS implemented from the client to the Office 365 Edge, and so you will be able to guarantee always a share of the bandwidth that will be enough to have good quality of calls. So that's really something we would recommend if you have problem.
Thanks. Quite a few questions about the impact of Express Routes.
So again, for Skype, we recommend it. It's generally, we've done different tests, and it generally, when you have problem, it's generally a good thing to have. For Exchange Online, we have done this test too. Again, you can find some of them on our website. And we haven't seen really a big difference on Exchange. It's more reliable than traditional ISP, for sure. But in terms of performance, you won't see necessary any improvement. You will see, again, you will see a better reliability of the service, but not necessarily a better performance for Exchange Online.
Right, but on Skype for Business, you will probably see you know, some better performance there using the Express Route, because there's QoS built in for that as well in the Express Route.
Yeah. Any other question?
Yeah, there's one last before we move on to the end. Can alerts be set up to notify admins when thresholds are reached on certain values?
So the answer is yes. Of course, like every robot user that we have seen. On every other robot user, you can configure threshold, of course, and based on this threshold, you can be alerted if the threshold is reached, of course. So, no, absolutely no problem for that. It's really one of the basic of the monitoring that is done by our robot user. No problem. And of course, these robot user, because I've seen quickly another question. So, these robot user, for them to work well, you need to install them where your users are, okay? So we've seen on the different tests, and we have a robot user for us, for example, in Philadelphia, in New York, we have other in Nice, in south of France. I mean, we have our robot user where the users are. They sit in the same location, they are using the same protocol, and they are performing exactly the same action. So you can install robot user on a virtual machine, on a laptop, for example, and then they really are your user and they're really performing this action. A last point as well that we haven't seen on Exchange, but I mean, I could continue to speak like that for hours. They are doing the work for Exchange as well with ActiveSync. So you can choose between the protocol that they are used. We have seen MAPI and also AWS. And when they are using ActiveSync, they are really simulating an Android device that is performing action on Office 365. So that's also something that might be interesting for you.
Thank you very much. We're just about to go over time with this, so we did not get the chance to answer all the questions, but please be assured that we'll get back to you in the next days. Well, thank you everyone for your participation. Evaluation is about to show up in your browser, so please take a moment to provide us with your feedback. And thank you again, everyone, for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you everybody. And again, if we haven't answered all your questions, no worry. We will send you an answer this week to all of you. No problem. Thank you very much, and have a good day.
Thanks for joining.
Bye bye.
Bye.